Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, welcome back, folks. And I'm again happy to welcome our next speaker in the schedule, which is Praneeth Netrapali. Praneeth did his undergrad from IIT Bombay, and then like Pratik and Aditya, did his PhD from UT Austin, and now he's a postdoc at our New England lab, Microsoft Research New England lab, and I'll hand it over to Pratik. Thanks, Pratik.
Thanks, Satish, and thanks to the organizers for inviting me. In this two parts, I'll be talking about PCA. And the first part will be an introduction to PCA, where I'll cover some very basic fundamental results on PCA, which make PCA so widely used and important. And in the second talk, I'll talk about what is known as robust PCA, more on that later. Okay. So dimensionality reduction is one of the most widely used techniques in data analysis. For instance, if you have data points in some high dimensional space, what we do is we do PCA on this space. PCA gives us the directions which have the largest variance and the second largest variance and so on. And in many cases, it turns out that the data is captured by very few dimensions. And once we project onto these dimensions, we don't really lose much information by this projection, and the projected data still captures most of the information that we initially had, and we can do whatever algorithms we want to run on this low dimensional data. This has two advantages. One is statistical, which is that if there is noise and the noise has equal variance in all the directions, then projecting all the data onto lower dimensions decreases the amount of noise. So this gives a better signal to noise ratio. And the second is computational. If we worked on the original data points, we would be working in a very high dimensional space, and projecting all of them into lower dimensions and working on this lower dimensional space lets us design algorithms which are much more efficient and can scale to much larger data sets. Let's look at an example. This is an example where each data point corresponds to the skull of a mammal, and the idea is to distinguish between various species. And in high dimensions, there are two kinds of variances. One is the difference within a species, and one is the variation across the species. And the idea is that the variation across species is of much more importance and much larger than the variation within a species. So the top PCA dimensions capture the variance which happens across the species. And so when we project all the data into the top PCA dimensions, we get a picture of this sort, where the data points corresponding to a particular species tend to cluster, and data points which correspond to different species are much farther apart compared to the variation within the species. PCA actually has many more applications, even in computational linear algebra and so on. For instance, it is very important in solving a system of linear equations, which is one of the most widely occurring problems in any sort of numerical system. The same with computing pseudo-inverse for solving system of linear equations. And this is PCA is also a building block of basic building block of many other and more advanced algorithms. So let me first let us now see what PCA is. PCA also goes by the name of singular value decomposition, or SVD. The SVD of a given matrix M is its factorization as U sigma V transpose, where U and V are orthonormal column matrices. So each column of both U and V have norm 1, and two distinct columns of U and V are orthogonal to each other. So U and V are orthonormal column matrices. Sigma is a diagonal matrix with all diagonal elements being positive entries, and they are arranged in the descending order. So sigma 1 is greater than or equal to sigma 2 up to sigma m, and these are called the singular values. This gives a very nice representation of the matrix M as a linear operator. So if the matrix M is so the matrix M can be seen as an operator from the space Rn to Rm. So let me try to write this. So let's say M is an M cross N matrix. Where the vector v goes to mv. This representation gives a very nice intuitive description of what the operator looks like. So it takes an orthogonal basis v and it scales them appropriately and then puts them into an orthogonal basis in the Rm space. So you take an orthogonal space v, you scale each of the directions by the corresponding singular values, and you then put them in this orthogonal basis U. And we'll see why this U is very intuitive in the next few slides. And I should also mention that the SVD is unique under some qualifications, which we'll see in the next slide. For symmetric matrices, okay, so SVD is defined even for non-square matrices, so M and M need not be equal, but for symmetric matrices, both the dimensions are equal, and moreover, if the matrix is symmetric, U is equal to plus or minus V, where each column can have the same sign or the negative sign. And U, the left eigenvectors of M are the left singular vectors of M are the eigenvectors of MM transpose. This can be seen easily because we can write MM transpose as U sigma V transpose times V sigma U transpose. This is nothing but U sigma square U transpose. So if you multiply any vector, if you multiply this matrix with a vector UI, U transpose UI is going to be just the indicator vector of that particular component. So that will be EI, and then we'll be multiplying with sigma I square and then U, and this is equal to sigma I square. So let's see how we construct the SVD of any given matrix M. So we look at the functional, function, the norm of MV, and if we try to maximize over all unit vectors V, the two norm of MV, then we get a vector which is V1. So this set is compact, so the maximum is achieved at some point, and the vector that we get is the first singular vector V1. And the normalized version of MV1 is the first left singular vector U1. And the norm that the norm of MV1 is the first singular value sigma 1. So this is a very nice way to start building an SVD, because the important result here is that, so if we define V1 in that way, then take any W which is orthogonal to V1, we have that MW is orthogonal to MV1. So once we remove the projection of, how V1 is operated upon by M, then the resulting matrix sets V1 to 0, and it only acts on the orthogonal space and sends it to the orthogonal space of MV1. So we have essentially reduced the rank of the matrix. Is this clear? Or should we see how it is? Okay. So once we have this result, it's very easy to build the remaining components of the SVD by defining them as argmax over all the orthogonal spaces of all the singular vectors that we have recovered so far. So V2 in particular will be R max over all unit norm vectors V, which are orthogonal to V1 of MV. And U2 will just be the normalized version of MV2. And sigma 2 is the norm of MV2. This also, so this argument also tells us that the singular value, singular vectors are unique whenever the singular values are distinct. So for instance, if sigma 1 is strictly greater than sigma 2, so when sigma 1 is greater than sigma 2, so sigma, so let's say we have the singular value decomposition, and there is another singular value decomposition. So the max over any vector V such that the L2 norm is 1 of MV is equal to, so from this characterization it is equal to sigma 1, and for any other vector it is strictly less than sigma 1. And similarly, for from this characterization we know that it is indeed equal to sigma 1 hat, and so sigma 1 should be equal to sigma 1 hat. And from this characterization, since we also know that V is the unique vector that achieves this, V hat should be exactly, V hat 1 should be exactly equal to V1. So as we just saw in the previous slide, the spectral norm or the operator norm, which is the max over all vectors of MV, is equal to the top singular vector, value V, sigma 1. And the Frobenius norm, which is the square root of sum of all the squares of sum of all the entries, is equal to the L2 norm of the singular values. And we can also define more norms using the singular values, which are known as the Shatten P norms. These are just the LP norms over the vector of singular values. So all of these are very useful in many applications. And in the next talk, I'll show you. Okay, so let's look at a special case of this one, which is the Shatten 1 norm. Which is just the sum of the singular values. This is also called the trace norm or the nuclear norm of the matrix M, and this is used in convex relaxations of rank minimization problems. So let us see a simple application of SVD to see how we can glean how we can recover say very interesting things about matrices by just using the SVD. The lemma here says that if M is square and it has orthonormal columns, then it also has orthonormal rows. So M is a matrix with, let's say, MI denotes the ith column of ith column of M, and MJ. So delta IJ is equal to 1 if I equal to J and 0 otherwise. Then the lemma says that it also, so M also has orthonormal rows, which means that so if M superscript I denotes a row, so this result is easy to recover once we understand the SVD. So in order to see this, what does M having orthonormal columns mean? You take any unit vector V here, and you hit M with V, then the norm of the resulting vector is equal to 1, because you are just taking, so MV is equal to summation VI. And the norm of this is equal to summation over I Vi Bj delta ij. And this is nothing but so the norm of MV is equal to 1, which means that all the singular values are equal to 1. Sorry? So if it has orthonormal columns, it is called a rotation matrix. So you take one orthogonal system, orthogonal basis, and move, rotate it to another orthogonal basis. So M is indeed a rotation matrix. So the point is, so all we are told here is that in the column space, M rotates an orthogonal basis to another orthogonal basis. What we are showing here is that even when you look at as row transformation, when you hit it from the left, even then it acts as an orthogonal transformation from one orthogonal basis to another orthogonal basis. So the fact that MV is equal to 1 for every V means that all the singular values are equal to 1. Once you know that all the singular values are equal to 1, we know that you can hit the matrix M with any vector from the left and you will still get the norm of the resulting vector is still equal to 1. And this then tells us that the rows of M are also orthonormal, because for every vector, every row vector that you hit from the left, the norm is equal to 1. What is an inherent?
A transpose A equals to I, or A into A transpose equals to I. That will also reflect the same lemma.
Yeah. So orthonormal columns only tells you directly without using anything else that M transpose M is equal to identity. What we have shown here is that this implies that whenever M is square, M transpose M equal to identity implies that M M transpose is also equal to identity.
It is also reflecting the same lemma, I think so.
Yeah, it is the same lemma. But the proof goes via, the proof I have tried to show here goes via SVD, and this at least to me makes things very clear as to why this is true. Okay, so the reason why SVD or PCA is so widely used and so important, one of the basic reasons is the Yekhart-Young-Mirsky theorem, which says that if M is equal to U sigma V transpose is the SVD of a matrix M, then the best rank R, rank K approximation of M is always given by the top singular components of the SVD. And now what do we mean by the best approximation? We can measure the error in various norms. The original result was proved for the Frobenius norm, and Mirsky later proved the theorem for any unitarily invariant norm, which means that so a norm is unitarily invariant if you hit the matrix with any rotation matrix and the norm does not change. So you rotate your basis to a different orthogonal basis and the norm does not change, that is called a unitarily invariant norm. But for now let us just focus on the spectral norm and the Frobenius norm. What this says is that for any rank A matrix A, the error achieved by the spectral norm of M minus A is at least the spectral norm achieved by UK sigma K VK transpose. This difference is nothing but UK plus 1 sigma K plus 1 VK plus 1 transpose, and spectral norm of that is just sigma K plus 1. And a similar statement holds for the Frobenius norm, which tells us that the top singular components is the best rank A approximation for M even in the Frobenius norm. Is this clear? So the idea is that so whenever we say we want to approximate in rank A, it means that we want, so we are in very high dimensions, say we are in dimension N, and we want to project all the data points to dimension K. That's what the rank K here means. So it's saying that the best space to project in to minimize the errors is given by the top singular directions. Uh, Let's look at the proof of Yekhart-Young-Mirsky theorem for the spectral norm case. So just to recall notation, M is a matrix we are trying to approximate, and A is any matrix of rank k, and we want to show that the spectral norm of this difference is at least sigma k plus 1. So the rank of A is less than or equal to k, which means that the null space of A, the null space of A has dimension at least n minus k. This is just the rank nullity theorem. Now, since the dimension of the null space of A is n minus k, we look at the range of vk plus 1, which are the top k plus 1 right singular vectors. These are all orthogonal to each other and hence they are independent. So the dimension of this space is at least k plus 1. So the total sum of dimensions here is at least n plus 1. So there exists at least one vector which is in the intersection of this space and this space, and let's call it x. So what is the property of x? So A times x is equal to 0 because x is in null space of A, and x is also in the range of vk plus 1, which means that it can be expressed just as a linear combination of v1 to vk plus 1. And the two norm of m minus a times x, so the spectral norm of m minus a is at least m minus a, the norm of m minus a times x, which is summation I equal to 1 to k plus 1 sigma I square x vi square. This is just because so ax is equal to 0 and mx is equal to summation sigma I x vi ui, and x just lies in the space of the top k plus 1, so this is just and since ui are orthonormal, the norm of this vector is just the sum of squares of these things, which is just this, and all the sigma i's are greater than or equal to sigma k plus 1, and we have this result. So I could not find a very simple proof of the Eckhart-Young-Mirsky theorem for the Frobenius norm case. So I'll just give an intuition of why it is true for rank 1. This can be generalized to arbitrary rank as well, but the proof becomes much more complicated. At least for the rank 1 case, we are looking at the optimization problem, which is minimizing M minus UV transpose Frobenius square, where we have choice over the vectors u and v. This automatically enforces a rank 1 condition. The stationary points of this objective function are given by the equations, which is m minus uv transpose times v equal to 0 and u transpose m minus uv transpose equal to 0. So this is just gotten by setting gradient equal to 0. So if we combine both of these equations, what we get is that M transpose MV is equal to M transpose. So we use the first equation, second equation to get, we use the first equation to get M transpose times V transpose V times U, and V transpose V is a scalar, which is M transpose U. This is again U transpose U times. So V are the eigenvectors of the matrix M transpose M. And from SVD, we know that the only the eigenvectors of M transpose M are precisely the right singular vectors of M. And this tells us that U and V have to be left and right singular vectors of M. And once we, since we only have n choices for these eigen singular vectors, we can just plug in all of them and see that this is minimized by the top singular vectors. So one of the major areas of study in SVD and related matrix factorization questions is the stability of any of these factorizations. In practice, what we are interested in is a matrix L, but what we observe is a noisy version of the matrix, which is L plus N. So we observe M, which is the desired matrix L plus a noise matrix N. And the perturbation questions here mean that how do the singular values of M differ from the singular values of L as a function of the various properties of the matrix N. For instance, can we bound this by the speckle norm of N? And how do the singular vectors themselves change between M and L? This is particularly important because if we are just going to do a dimensionality reduction by projecting onto the top spaces, we want to see that if we take a PCA of the observed matrix, we get certain directions. We want them to be very close to the actual directions that we would have gotten if we had used the true matrix L. So we want the top directions of the top PCA directions of M to be very close to the top directions of L. And the question is, how far can they be depending on the noise parameter N? Yeah, in many applications, you need to center your data to remove the mean.
So the matrix M that you're talking about is a homogeneous matrix translation is also part of it.
So it depends on your application. So in many, so these are all just about arbitrary matrices M. So in your application, if you think that there is a lot of bias, which is a mean that you want to remove before you do this, then you would center the matrix and do all this analysis on the centered matrix. But all these results hold for arbitrary matrices M.
But it requires that it has to be centered on
that depends on your application. It need not be centered for an arbitrary matrix. All these results hold true even for arbitrary matrices. So the classical results in this area of perturbation analysis are Weyl's inequalities and the Davis-Kahan theorem. So the setting is the same as before, where M is equal to L plus N, where L is the matrix that we are interested in and N is the noise matrix, M is the matrix that we observe. So there are lots of inequalities that go by the name Weyl's inequalities. One of the most widely used in at least machine learning that I have seen is the fact that any two, the kth singular values of M and L do not differ by more than the speckle norm of N. There are much stronger results relating the various eigenvalues of the perturbed matrix and the non-perturbed matrix. There are even what are called interlacing eigenvalues, interlacing eigenvalue theorems and so on. But for most of the purposes that I have encountered so far, all I ever needed to use was inequalities of this sort. Okay, so Weyl's inequalities tell us something about the perturbation in the singular values. What Davis-Kahan theorem tells us is how the singular vectors are perturbed. So let's take a moment to parse this equation. So uk of m corresponds to the top left k singular vectors of m. Uk of l corresponds to the top k left singular vectors of l. Uk of m, uk of m is the space of the top k left singular vectors of m. Uk of m perp denotes the orthogonal space to this k singular vectors. So this is of dimension n minus k. And then you take the transpose and you hit it with the top k space of L. So this matrix is taking a vector in this space and then projecting onto the orthogonal space of uk of m. And the spectral norm here measures, so over all vectors in uk of l, what is the maximum length of its projection onto the orthogonal space? Okay, so let's see an example of what this. So if UK of M equals UK of L, then UK perp transpose times UK is equal to 0. So if the singular vector spaces are fully aligned, then this inner product, this matrix, as a matrix, it's equal to 0. So its spectral norm is equal to 0. So there is no perturbation. The question is, since these two are not exactly equal, there is some difference between these two subspaces, and this matrix somehow captures what are the projections of each of the vectors onto this orthogonal space, and the spectral norm measures how large can the projection of a vector in this subspace be onto the orthogonal subspace. This is a matrix. So UK of M, so UK of M perp is a subspace. UK of M perp is a orthogonal basis of that subspace. Any orthogonal basis of that subspace. So you take the transpose. So this will be n times n minus k. N minus k. So each row of this matrix, UK perp transpose, corresponds to a basis vector of the orthogonal space. So there are n minus k such basis vectors because the dimension is n minus k, and you hit it with a n cross k matrix. Because UK of L is of dimension k.
Is there an implicit maximum supremum over all possible choices of basis for the perp?
So it actually does not depend on the particular choice of basis. Okay. Sure. Right. So that is because you can look at this as the projection of. So take any vector here. So this is essentially the projection of this vector onto this basis. So changing the basis does not really change the spectral norm or length of the vectors. So all of them remain the same. The matrix itself might change, but the singular values and it's just a rotation of the space. So the spectral norm here tells us what is the largest projection of any vector in this subspace onto the orthogonal subspace. And what Davis-Kahan theorem tells us is that this number is bounded at most by the spectral norm of n, so n is the noise matrix, over the eigen gap, which is sigma k of L minus sigma k plus 1 of L. And this is in some sense tight. I think there may be constant, no, there is no constant. So this dependence on both of these is tight because, so if you have an identity matrix and you are, so say you have a rank, so 2x2 matrix, which is just identity, and you have a noise matrix, or say 1 plus epsilon 0, 0, 1, and you add a noise matrix, which is minus epsilon 0, 0, epsilon, then so. So the top singular vector of the matrix L is the first unit vector, it's 1 plus epsilon, whereas the top singular vector of this matrix M is the second vector E2. So you have moved from E1 being the top vector to E2, which is completely orthogonal by just adding a very small epsilon amount of noise whenever these two eigenspaces are not very well separated. So this dependence is tight, and there are examples which show that this is tight. You cannot get hope for anything better than this unless you have more constraints on the noise matrix end. Yeah. Okay. So for instance, if the noise matrix n were random, then it would be very hard to believe that the singular vectors would exactly align with the top directions of this and then skew them in such a bad way. So we can get better results when the noise matrix n is random, but in the deterministic setting this is tight. So Okay, so just before finishing, I have maybe two exercises that let's try to work this out. So the first exercise is that say L was low rank, and what we observe is M, which is a corrupted version of N, and we want to have a low, so we know that L is low rank, so we want to have a low dimensional projection of M, which is still close to L. What this lemma says is that the top k projection of M minus L is at most twice the spectral norm of N. So you may be blowing up the error between M and L by a factor of 2, but you still have a low dimensional representation as opposed to a high dimensional representation M. So any ideas on how we should proceed? Reduce the dimensionality of your data points, but still not blow up your error by too much.
N being a larger dimension matrix.
Yeah, all of them are say n cross n matrices, so all of them are large in dimension, but when you project them onto the k dimensions, you are reducing the dimensionality of each data point. And what I am trying to say here is that even when you project all these to just dimension k from dimension n, you don't lose the approximation distance from L by more than a factor of 2.
But your main idea is to remove M from your error due to M.
No, it's usually not possible to remove it completely. At least what we are trying to do here is, unless you have additional knowledge about the noise N, it's not possible to remove it entirely. So what we what this tells us at least is that, so you have a representation which is close up to a factor of N in a very high dimension. What this tells us is that we can project all of these into low dimensions, and presumably this could have blown up the error, but it does not, and you can get a low dimensional representation which blows up the error by only a factor of 2. Why is, so this is the definition of SVD? PCA? No, oh sorry, so PK of M is the top K projection of M, so you don't know L, so L is something that we only use in analysis. What we have access to is just M, so PK of M is you take M, project it onto its top K components, and that's PK of M. So PK of M is the PC of M, not L. Orthogonal what? I don't know what that is.
So the boundless side when the first the top k vector in L becomes the last in M, and for the second becomes the second last in M. That is why the factor of 2.
No, then I. Well, I don't know if the factor 2 here is tight, probably not, at least in the case when the singular vectors just get interchanged, you don't have the factor of 2. Okay, so let's just see the proof. So we want to look at the spectral norm of L minus PK of M, so you add and subtract M. right? So, and then we use triangle inequality to get M minus L speckle norm plus M minus PQ of M speckle norm. So, this is just by adding and subtracting M, and we know by Young-Eckardt theorem that, okay, L is rank K. So, we know by Young-Eckardt theorem that M minus L is at least M minus PQ of M, because L is rank K and the best rank K projection is given by PQ of M. So, the summation is at most twice M minus L 2 norm, which is just the 2 times the speckle norm of N. This is again just by triangle inequality. Right. And the same, essentially the same argument using Eckardt-Young theorem for the Frobenius norm instead of the speckle norm gives us this. Right. But I would argue that this is not as good as this was. And why is that? So, so the Frobenius norm, so on the right hand side, so we have an upper bound, so we would want the upper bound to be as small as possible. And the matrix we have here on the right hand side is a n cross n matrix. So the Frobenius norm of an n cross n matrix, so the Frobenius norm of a matrix usually grows with the dimension. So for instance, if n was some small epsilon times an identity matrix, then the Frobenius norm would be epsilon times square root n. So even though we are projecting all the data points to a low dimension, the error bound we have here depends on the dimension before projection. And this is not good, because even if the error was very small in each of the dimensions, when you take the Frobenius norm, all of them will add up and you will have a blow up in the error of the noise matrix, right. So, but this is not tight. So, okay, let us look at another exercise. It is the same setting as before. We have the Frobenius norm on the left, and instead of the Frobenius norm on the right, we have 2 square root 2 k times the speckle norm of n. So, this I argue will not have the dependence on the initial dimension n, because you are just using the speckle norm and the speckle norm usually does not scale with the dimension, and the additional factor you are incurring is not just 2, it is 2 square root 2 k, where k is the underlying k is the dimension that you are projecting onto, and this is usually much smaller than the ambient dimension n. So, in most of the cases this would be much tighter than the previous bound we had, which was the Frobenius norm of n here. So, how do we prove this? You get a square root n, not square root k. So the matrices are of ambient dimension n cross n. L is low rank, but n is not low rank. So if you just take the Frobenius norm of n, it can only be bounded by square root n times the speckle norm of n, not by square root k. Okay, so this again can be proved easily using SVD. So we know that L minus PK of M, this is at most a rank 2k matrix, because L is rank k and PK of M is rank k. So the summation is at most a rank 2k matrix. So it has at most 2k non-zero singular values. So the Frobenius square of L minus PK of M can be written as U the tray. So this is just the So the Frobenius square is just trace of A transpose. And since we know that L minus pk of M is just rank 2k, we can just take the 2k singular vectors of L minus pk of M and multiply them in the left and the right. This does not change the trace because so let me do it. So let A equal to U sigma B transpose. What I am saying is that so we know that the Frobenius norm of A square equals summation sigma I square, and this is indeed equal to the trace of U transpose A transpose U, because this is just trace of U transpose U sigma B transpose is just sigma B transpose V sigma, because U transpose is equal to identity, and U transpose equal to identity, and this is just nothing but trace of sigma square, which is summation over sigma square. So the point is you only have to work in a low dimensional space because the matrix L minus pk of M is rank 2k. So you just hit the 2k singular vectors on the left, 2k singular vectors on the right, and now we can expand L minus pk of M as before by adding and subtracting M, L minus M plus M minus pk of M. Now once you put that here, you will get terms of the form U transpose A B transpose U, where A is equal to L minus M and B is equal to M minus pk of M. And since U is of dimension at most 2k, this whole inner product can be bounded by 2k times the spectral norms of A and B. And we again know that the spectral norm of M minus pk of M is at most the spectral norm of M minus L. So this can again be bounded by the spectral norm of M minus L whole square. And then just taking the square roots gives us this result. So M minus L is just N, and you get this result. There is no relation between U and AB. So all we are using here is that U is of dimension 2k. That's it. Because what is the trace here? So you take the first row times AB transpose times the first column, which can be so. Because UA are unit length. Right. Okay. I think that's all I wanted to say, at least in the first talk. So to summarize, SVD's PCA is indeed one of the fundamental tools in many data analysis applications whenever we are in very high ambient dimension and we want to reduce our dimensionality. And in most of these cases, it's very important to understand what happens when you have small perturbations in the data, because you never observe the exact data, you always have some perturbations, and it's very crucial to understand how the projection how the projecting spaces change when you have small perturbations and all these questions. As we have seen, the tight results are known for perturbation in the L2, the operator norm, which is spectral norm, and the Frobenius norms by Davis-Kahan theorem and extensions of the Davis-Kahan theorem. What I will be talking about later is perturbation results in the L infinity norm. So as I said, Eckert-Young theorem is true only for unitarily invariant norms, which are the norms which do not change with by hitting with a rotation matrix. L infinity norms are not unitarily invariant, so those results do not apply in this setting. And in many cases, when you have very nice structure on the noise matrix N, you can say much more than just bounds on the Speckle norm and Frobenius norms of the projections. And in one of those settings, I'll be talking about how we can bound perturbations in the L infinity norm when there is structured noise. Yeah, so that's all I have. And these are some of the references I found useful for learning about SVD. And this one for Weyl's inequalities. Yeah, thank you.